biology.
So, let's look at the different structures as seen under the electron microscope, because we are going to see that there is a very high difference between the structure seen in the light microscope and in the electron microscope of a cell. So, let's begin with the cell membrane. As you can see on the diagram, the cell membrane is seen as a double layer whereby it has phospholipid layers to the outside, and then to the central part we have the protein layer. So the substances are transported between the two different phospholipid layers using a physiological process which is called active transport, and another one is diffusion. So we are going to look at these physiological processes and define them and see how they come about. So the next structure that we are going to look at is now the endoplasmic reticulum. So what you should note before we begin is that the endoplasmic reticulum, they originate from the nucleus. So we have two different types of endoplasmic reticulum, whereby the first one is the rough endoplasmic reticulum, as you can see in the diagram. So the rough endoplasmic reticulum contains ribosomes, whereby we are going to look at the function of the ribosomes. So the function of the rough endoplasmic reticulum is to transport proteins. Also, we have the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, whereby the function of the smooth endoplasmic reticulum is to transport lipids. So let's look at the ribosomes. So the ribosomes, these are very small structures which are located or found on the rough endoplasmic reticulum. And what's the function of the ribosomes? So the function of the ribosomes is that they synthesize or they manufacture proteins. So after they have manufactured proteins, so the proteins enter into the rough endoplasmic reticulum for transportation to the nucleus and the nucleolus for different processes of the cell. Let's look at the other organelle. So the other organelle, we have the Golgi bodies, whereby the function of the Golgi bodies is that they package and transport glycoprotein within the cell. The other function of the Golgi bodies is that they produce the lysosome. So as you can see, the Golgi body, they look exactly the same as the endoplasmic reticulum. Now the difference between the Golgi body and the endoplasmic reticulum is that the endoplasmic reticulum originate from the nucleus, while the Golgi bodies are located anywhere on the cytoplasm of the cell. So let's look at the next organelle, whereby we see we have the mitochondria. So if it is one, it's called mitochondrial. If there are many, it's called mitochondrial. So these are rod-shaped organelle. So they have an outer membrane and the inner membrane, which is greatly folded into structures which are called cristae. So the main function of the mitochondrion is to produce energy. So they are the power source or the energy source of the cell. So they produce energy. So the other organelle, we have the lysosome, whereby these are organelles which mainly contain hydrolytic or hydrolytic enzyme. So the function of the lysosome is that they destroy harmful microorganisms and substances which are found inside the cell. Also, we have another organelle, which is the chloroplast, as you can see. So the chloroplast is mainly found in the plant cell. It is not found in the animal, but it is only found in the plant cell. So the chloroplast has grana for the light stage in photosynthesis, and it has stroma for the dark stage in photosynthesis, as you can see in the diagram. So we have the grana, then the light ringing, the one grana from the next is called the intergrana or the lamella, and then we have the stroma, whereby dark stage of photosynthesis takes place. But what's now the difference between the animal cell and the plant cell? Like, what's the difference? Because earlier on we said that they are both cells, yes, but they are different. So let's look at the differences. So the plant cell and the animal cell. Well, but we see that the plant cell has cell wall, while the animal cell does not have a cell wall. It only has a cell membrane. So in the plant cell also, we see that the nucleus is located towards the side of the cell, while in the animal cell, the nucleus is centrally located. So in the plant cell, these cells have chloroplast for photosynthesis, while the animal cells do not have any chloroplast. So looking at the vacuole, we see that the plant cell has a very large vacuole, while the animal cell, they don't have a vacuole, and if a vacuole is present, it will be very small. Also, looking at it morphologically, we will say that the plant cell is very large, when the animal cell is always very small. So the plant cell is regular shaped, while the animal cell is irregularly shaped. So for the plant cell, you will notice that they do not have a centriole, while the animal cells, they have a centriole. So for the plant cell, they store oil, starch, and protein, while they're in animal cell, they store fat and glycogen molecules. So finally, let's look at temporary preparation of slides. So in the temporary preparation of slides, we are going to look at different subtopics, but let's begin. So we have two different types of slides before we enter into our subtopic, whereby we have a permanent slide and then we have a temporary slide. So in this case, we are going to look at temporary slide. So a temporary slide is mainly prepared for the current use, while a permanent slide will be prepared for use over and over again in long periods of experiment cycles. So the temporary slide, the other name of the temporary slide, it may also be called a wet slide, since the specimen is always placed on a liquid drop, as we will see on the different subtopics. So after preparing the specimen, we will place it on a liquid drop. So what are the different steps in preparing a temporary slide? So the first step is called sectioning. So what is sectioning? So this is cutting very thin slices of the specimen using a scalpel or a petri dish which contains water. So a forceps or a microtome apparatus may be used to remove the epidermis of the leaf, or may be used to cut very thin slices of the specimen. So we have different types of sections, whereby we have the transverse section and also we have the longitudinal section. So the transverse section is obtained by cutting across the length of the specimen, as you can see in the diagram. So if you cut the specimen across, that is called the transverse section. So the other type of section is called the longitudinal section, just from the word the longitude, from top to bottom. So this is obtained by cutting along the specimen. So if you cut along the specimen or from the top to bottom, that is a longitudinal section. So next step is called fixation, whereby this involves treating the specimen with 70% of ethanol or 99% of ethanoic acid, which is mixed with 1% of glacial ethanoic acid. So these chemicals are called fixative. So a fixative, this is a chemical which is used in the fixation process. So what's the importance of fixation? So the importance of fixation is that it is carried out for two reasons. So the first reason is to maintain the specimen structure and also to make the specimen hard enough for very thin sections to be cut. So the third step is called staining, whereby this makes it easier to identify different parts of the specimen. So the common stains which are used, we have iodine, we have methyl blue, we have methyl red, we have neutral red, and then finally we have eosine, among others. So lastly, the last step is mounting, whereby this is placing the specimen gently on the slide that is to be observed on the microscope. So what are the steps in mounting? So the first step is to place a drop of water on the slide that you want to mount the specimen. So after doing this, you should lower the specimen gently on the slide and spread it over. So after that, you should lower a cover slip at an angle to cover the specimen on the slide. So never lower the cover slip directly, but lower it at an angle. So why should you do this? This is done in order to avoid trapping air bubbles on the specimen, which will alter the results that you will be observing. So let's now go to cell specialization and define what is cell specialization. So cell specialization, so this is the modification of a cell to be able to perform a specific function. So the modification of a cell to be able to perform a specific function is called cell specialization. What are the advantages of cell specialization? So the first advantage is that, so the cell becomes efficient in conducting its activities, whereby we are going to look at different cells that are specialized to carry out different functions. So what are the disadvantages of cell specialization? We see that the cells are unable to perform certain tasks, and therefore they depend on other cells to be able to perform for them the different tasks. Like maybe for example, the red blood cell cannot manufacture its own food, so it depends on other cells to manufacture their own food so that it can be able to nourish itself. So the cells specialized are different in animals and in plants. So first of all, let's begin with the plant, the animal, and look at the red blood cell as the first cell which is specialized. So the red blood cells transports oxygen, that's the only function. What are the adaptations of the red blood cells? So the first adaptation is that it is biconcave. Why? To increase the surface area for gas to diffuse in it for transportation. So the second adaptation, we say that it contains hemoglobin. And what's the function of the hemoglobin? So the hemoglobin has a very high affinity for oxygen. So oxygen is always absorbed or react with hemoglobin for easier transportation to the areas where it is required. So the red blood cell also lacks nucleus. And what's the function of the red blood cell lacking nucleus? So this provides a large area by which oxygen or dissolved gases will be transported inside the red blood cell. So the other cell which is specialized in animals, we see that we have the sperm cell. So what's the function of the sperm cell? The only function of the sperm cell is to fertilize the ovum. And the other function is that it transmits hereditary traits to the offspring. So those are the two main functions of the sperm cell. So what are the adaptations of the sperm cell? As you can see, we see that the sperm cell contains a very strong tail, which is called flagellum for propulsion. It also contains a large amount of mitochondria for energy production, and it also has the head contains lytic enzyme for easier digestion of the ovum walls for easier penetration. So we also have the white blood cell, whereby the function of the white blood cell is to fight harmful microorganisms. Remember, I didn't say microorganisms, but I say the function is to destroy and fight harmful microorganisms. What are the adaptations of the white blood cells? We see that it has lymphocytes and the phagocytes, which play a part in the destruction of the harmful microorganisms in the body, among others. So we are going to look at this in depth when it comes to the topic of transportation, that is in form 2. So the other cell adapted is, we have platelets, whereby it's another cell which is specialized. So the function of the platelets is that it forms a clot. So if the blood vessels are ruptured, so the platelets, they form a clot to stop bleeding of the blood vessel. So what are the adaptations of the platelets? We see that they are very tiny, they are also very many, and they also contain enzymes which are responsible for clotting. So let's look at the specialized plant cells. So the first plant cell we have the palisade cells. So the palisade cells, they have chloroplast. What's the function of chloroplast? Photosynthesis. What are the adaptations of the palisade cells? I'll just list them. So the first one is that they are very many. The second one is that they are closely packed. The third one is that they are located below the epidermis. So why are they located below the upper epidermis? So the function is that since the sun rays always hit the upper parts of the leaf, so that's where now the palisade cells are located, so that they can be able to absorb maximum sunlight. So that's why they are always located below the upper epidermis. They are also elongated and very large to be able to house a large number of chloroplasts. So let's look at the parenchyma cells, which are mainly the food storage reserve of the plant. So the parenchyma cell, their function is that they store the plant food. What are the adaptations of the parenchyma cells? So they have a very large subvacuole, and they are also very numerous to be able to serve that function. We also have the root hair. So the function of the root hair is that it absorbs nutrients, that is water and mineral salts, from the soil into the plant. What are the adaptations? They are thin and very small and very many. So they are thin, they are small, and they are also numerous. So they also have a very thin wall or a thin membrane. So what is the reason? So the reason is that the reason for having a very thin membrane for easier absorption of minerals or water and mineral salts into the plant from the soil. So the next one, we have the gut cell. So what's the function of the gut cell? So they control the opening and closing of the stomata. we see that they are also being shaped, which mainly facilitates this process. So let's meet on the next class as we now discuss on tissues. Biology.